I have to admit it, I was wrong. Bleach episode 4 was a great episode, but not without its skepticisms. But first, I must address the thought process from going from episode 3 to episode 4. After releasing my review on episode 3, I had many comments about my nitpicking, and while I did specifically say that these were my own personal issues, I gave the overall episode a positive rating. However, these comments on that video were really great, because when I was looking at it as a manga reader, I failed to see things outside of the adaptation itself. So, let's get into that. A main nitpick I had, for example, was the removal of Sunsun's ability and the dire situation that they were in, and while I thought that this would be a cool addition to keep in, I wasn't thinking about the logic that Ichigo would sit there and be a watcher while all of this is happening. Why would Ichigo allow Orihime and Chad and the Aronkars to get needlessly hurt for the sake of this cut alone? And this goes for many cuts, in fact, that were removed. I personally seem to have forgotten some vital things. Number 1. This adaptation is being overseen by Kubo himself, so I have to assume that Kubo was happy with these changes. Number 2, manga on a weekly basis will have to have padding to make that 20 page mark every week. So things such as Kira's explanation about the Rakungai and then later addressed yet again by Mayuri is redundant, and looking back may only be used to fill in the gaps of how Kubo wanted to start and finish the chapter of that week specifically. So yeah, there's padding in the manga that I just didn't take into consideration. It would seem to me that cuts like these are necessary for a good flow. So in regards to my nitpicking, I will have to hold off until we get a bigger picture, meaning until the core or even the series has finished, because we don't really know what the direction is going for until we at least get 12 to 13 episodes. Which now leads to episode 4. This episode does something somewhat similar where it removes conversation from the captains that are about to use Bankai. But if you're looking for the manga itself, they literally say the same thing that Byakuya does in that moment that we see in the anime. So it can be implied that they all think and do the exact same thing that Byakuya is saying. Would it be nice to have each voice actor maybe make an appearance and like say a line from that quote that Byakuya himself is saying? Possibly. But it doesn't remove the fact that these captains were thinking the same thing and did exactly the same thing. So it's a little less about hand-holding and just you as the audience making that assumption yourself, which is more thought-provoking in a sense. But before I talk about more of the controversies and my thoughts on them, let's talk about some really cool moments that I personally enjoyed. Usage of the hell butterflies to communicate was a nice touch, and a better depiction of them dissolving in comparison to the manga, where you just see little black bits, assuming that it's from the butterfly itself. Following with that, I really enjoyed the interaction between the Nanana and Rose, as we get to hear a tone with Rose that we're not really used to hearing from the character, and generally made him seem really badass. We get some really cool extra scenes, one of Mayuri doing some research, doing some schematics, doing some research on what's going on with the Bankai, to which, you know, he has the Soul Society equivalent of the blue screen of death, and Byakuya and Renji's probably really cool moment where they actually tag team against AsNodt, which again was not something in the manga. This was a really cool choreographic shot where you get to see AsNodt get absolutely blitzed right into the face. It goes to show just how good that these two can be when fighting a common enemy, and you know, they make really good synergy with that. And again, we get that really cool shot of AsNodt's eye and using the blue with that, and seeing the Sakura petal hit his iris was beautiful, an amazing shot, because it goes to show you how fearsome AsNodt is. And what can I say, the effects team when taking the Bankai just went burr. It just absolutely was beautiful to look at and an amazing depiction in and of itself. Throughout the episode, unfortunately, it always does feel like it's going so fast, and that's because there is so much going on in these episodes, and I overall enjoy it so much that time just flies by. And that's the problem, is that, you know, I think when time flies by, it goes to show you as an audience that you are engaged and that you are excited. And it is a common thing, besides all the criticisms that people want to give it, people always say that these episodes feel fast, because I feel that it's doing a good job in keeping you engaged and excited, and everything's always happening and there's a lot going on. I have to talk about Bambietta, because she made her amazing appearance this episode. Apparently is a football player now, because she used one of her bombs and kicked it right at Komamura, to which I will say, things of like the effects, even though we have a lot of blue within this episode, naturally the Quinces, when it comes to things like Bambietta's bombs, or you know, AsNodt's fear piercing little cones, the effects or the directions that these like effects go into look really distinguishable next to, you know, the rest of the reishi that they use. So that's a good thing in and of itself. I really enjoyed the fact that Asnodt didn't have to say a damn word in this episode, and you can already get the fear factor from him as a character. And I think that's what this episode really focused on the most, was the fact that you really wanted to get involved in Asnodt and Byakuya. That's going to be very pivotal next episode. So they're going to put all the attention on that. Things such as Nananana, Bambietta, even Kangdu as well. Bit of a spoiler, but they kind of come and go. You know, they display their dominance and then they dip. Whereas Asnodt is more of an impactful thing. It really drives home, and I think the direction goes a little bit crazy there. And when it came to Shunsui, it was panel for panel and a little bit more, and it was a statement. I think Shunsui getting hit that hard was a massive statement to get everyone's Bankai taken. Not everyone's, but four of the captain's Bankai taken, right? Which is scary in and of itself. It's a bit of a power move where everyone's like, oh, okay, it's about to go down. Then to actually damage a captain. We saw what happened to Kira. Then the next episode, you're going to get damaged to a captain. It's really building up to this is actually a big threat, and it's really solidifying that this is in fact a big threat. And that's what this episode was truly about. I'm glad about the Zenban Zakura with the Master Masculine putting him under the floor. You don't really get that shot really in the manga. He just kind of falls to the floor and Byakuya kind of explains what happens. Where in this case, in the episode, he doesn't have to explain what happens because you can see it visually. And I've noticed a lot with these Bleach episodes, you are seeing things visually then being told them. And that is a good Kubo trait of show but don't tell. And it's fantastic, and they're really displaying that really well. But I have to give my hats off to the effects team. They really carried this episode. Voice acting, as per usual, carried this episode as well. And some amazing animators worked on this episode. And to be fair, there is a lot. There is an absolute lot going on in this episode. There's a lot of fights kicking off, and we got a teaser of all of them. And I think I was extremely impressed, because there's going to be a lot of moving things. There's going to be a lot of Shinigami dying. There's going to be a lot of fights between the captains. So, you know, if this is the bare minimum of what we can expect from like a multi-magnitude fighting arena type style, then I'm all for it. However, as I said, the big thing about this was the, and I hate to say this, the character acting within the Shinigami when seeing Asnodt for the first time, because his piercing factor or his ability is the fear. And that makes anyone that he touches have like the biggest fear that they can possibly embrace, so to say. So seeing, you know, the Shinigami get stabbed and then them just completely screaming in agony was fantastic. And that's what I mean, like the voice acting really was one of the things that carried as well. It was, you know, special effects teams, voice actors, they absolutely did their thing. And I would be criminal if I didn't say this as well. The music was an amazing choice to make. Instead of using some high rocky style like action music going on, they used a very somber remix to Soundscape to Adore, I believe it's called, and a new remix of that, which I need to listen to when that drops, because that was a great remix and it was the best remix to use, because it really showed you that hype isn't happening right now. Really, despair is happening right now, and that tone really clicked with me a lot. It was something that I was addicted to listening when I heard that on my live reaction, if you haven't gone and checked that out. And then I guess we should talk about a bit of an elephant in the room, or two elephants in the room, so to say, and that is the recap and the speed lines. Now, a recap at this point by episode 4 shouldn't be happening. Now, considering that this was episodes 1 to 3, hopefully, you know, they don't do this for another 3 episodes by episode 7. You know, I hope that this isn't going to be a weekly thing. However, usually when there's a recap, in my mind, the first thing that I'm thinking of is, okay, there's going to be a lot of action in this episode. They're padding out for time. Yet, at the same time, and I have to kind of go back to a complaint that I had in the last episode, is that all those scenes that you are removing, you know, why couldn't you have extended those scenes to then bring onto episode 4, for example? But, you know, again, I don't know the direction. I know that they definitely use recap for padding. There shouldn't be a recap at this stage in the anime, personally. Thankfully, it wasn't too long, but we missed a almost good 5 minutes if you include the intro to a recap and an opening, which is not particularly good, right? But again, I'll hold off my judgments until I get the bigger picture. You know, it is an offense, sure, but I always believe that context is key, so I'm interested to see why they did it and if they're going to continue doing it later on. Let's talk about speed lines. I asked this question on Twitter about speed lines because, for me, I didn't personally mind it. It wasn't distracting. It wasn't, you know, off-putting. There is things that I'd change here and there. For there were speed lines on Byakuya when, like, Renji was telling him he was going to go Bankai, and then Byakuya said stop. I preferably would have preferred maybe a nice up close shot of Byakuya's mouth going stop in a very focused manner, and then seeing Renji's face rather than having speed lines towards Byakuya's character. Even though that was a one for one shot from the manga, I would have liked a little bit more creativity there. But, you know, just because I can think of something a little bit better per se, doesn't mean that the shot was bad in and of itself. Was there a lot of speed lines? Yes, there was. And I think that that is the problem, is that people don't have a problem with speed lines, but they have a problem with over excessive speed lines. There's many anime that do over excess speed lines a lot, My Hero Academia being one of them. But again, I've come to understand that it is a completely subjective experience on whether you like it or not. There was great movement in this episode. There wasn't that many still frames at all. It was consistently moving. I think, you know, showing the characters with Soifan and BG9 and Robert and Shunsui, doing that transition to seeing who matches up with who, using the speed lines in that effect is very good. However, there's speed lines that people didn't like, such as the Byakuya one that I used, for example. So you're always going to have hit and misses. Hopefully there's not as many speed lines as this episode in the next episodes, but I can understand maybe what they were trying to do. I feel like if there's anything with this episode, and this is kind of my conclusion to all of this and something that I really want you guys to understand, is that the problem with this episode, if there is one, it's definitely come to my conclusion that this is a storyboard issue. It's not an animation issue per se, it's a storyboard issue. And that's not entirely, you know, bad, because the person that's doing the storyboard is quite new to storyboarding. They haven't storyboarded many anime in general. So, you know, this is maybe one of their first. I want to say one of, because you never really know, but I can't throw a bit of a tantrum on that. Nor for the last episode either, because the storyboarder for the last episode as well wasn't really that good either, nor did they storyboard that much as far as my research went. Of course, I'm welcome to be proven wrong, but from their work of storyboarding in the past, doesn't seem all that impressive either. So, you know, it seems to me that episode 3 and 4 have had kind of novices in the storyboarding department, and I believe that this is the direction that it has gone to. But yeah, after speaking to a few people that, you know, are in the industry, many of their opinions believe that this was a setup episode. I know it's cope. I know a lot of Bleach fans are saying, oh, wait till the next episode, it's just starting things up. But, you know, even people from the industry are saying, yeah, this is very clear that this is a setup episode. And, you know, going from that, I can't disagree. I can't agree either. I don't know. You know, all I know is that I enjoyed this episode a lot. I did. I think it's one of the best. Obviously, I think one is the best, two is next, four, and then three. But again, all these episodes have been, you know, above average, and that's all we can ask for, is an above average adaptation, and that you can tell the passion they're putting into. So it has been fun every week. There's not a point where I'm like, oh, I'm dropping this, it's terrible, because it's been fantastic. And I will say the anime is actually making some corrections as well, because at the end as well, after Urahara blasted a hole within our friend Kyoge, who we probably won't see again, by the way, in the manga, in one of his last shots, you don't actually see the hole through his body, but in the anime you do. So the anime made corrections to the manga. So yeah, other than that, next episode is going to be a banger, and I'm excited for it. Other than that, tell me your guys' thoughts in the comment section down below, how you felt about this episode. Please like and subscribe, because it always does help me out. Like, seriously, subscribe. It really, really helps, like, a lot. And it also helps if you click on the videos as well in the future. That helps. But with that being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hanson, as always, people. Peace out.